Good afternoon. Let me briefly introduce myself. I'm Hagen Scherb from the Helmholtz-Zentrum München. I'm retired and I worked at the Helmholtz-Zentrum for more than 40 years. I'm most grateful today to Alex Rosen to be invited to talk to you about 10 years of living with Fukushima, effects of the nuclear catastrophe on perinatal morbidity and mortality. Since one can hardly talk about Fukushima without thinking of Chernobyl, I will initially address lessons learned from Chernobyl and will then focus on several specific aspects of Fukushima. I will emphasize the concept radiation-induced genetic effects, which today is widely ignored, unfortunately. Nevertheless, the narrative of radiation-induced genetic effects is fundamental to assessing, interpreting, and understanding the impacts of ionizing radiation and nuclear catastrophes on perinatal morbidity and mortality. This will be the content of my presentation. Firstly, I will try to explain the concept radiation-induced genetic effect, in as much it was informative and helpful as a basis of our diverse investigations and publications. The established term low dose is, in my opinion, highly misleading. It is producing much disinformation. To put it simply, low dose evolves from erroneously assuming that because of the natural background radiation does no major or visible harm to living beings, many multiples of the background radiation must be harmless as well. I will then sketch our findings concerning Chernobyl, which paved the way to our Fukushima studies. Main topic here are stillbirths, perinatal mortality, birth defects in Europe and Germany from country-level data down to district-level statistics. The Fukushima nuclear accidents have very many impacts on perinatal morbidity and mortality. I will focus on two aspects only. Perinatal mortality and low birth weight. Perinatal mortality in Japan today means death of the fetus or the newborn after 22 weeks of pregnancy to 7 days after birth. Low birth weight means being born with a weight below 2,500 grams. Finally, of course, as usual, several general concluding remarks and thoughts. The concept of radiation-induced genetic effect goes back to Hermann Mahler, who discovered X-ray mutagenesis in the 20s of the former century. Radiation-induced genetic effect means that the genetic information today known to be contained in the genes and the chromosomes can be changed, compromised, or even destroyed by ionizing radiation. Mahler was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1946 for his discoveries. Detrimental genetic effects in human populations may become visible as increased childhood cancers, congenital malformations, chromosome anomalies, stillbirths, which are often the consequence of severe birth defects, neonatal mortality, perinatal deaths, low birth weight newborns, infant deaths, and finally, sex ratio of stillbirths or live births. As early as in 1958, the United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation, UNSCEAR, acknowledged that an increase in the frequency of radiation-induced mutations in humans, some of which could be lethal, might be associated with statistically visible effects. Those statistically visible effects would manifest themselves to some unknown extent as increases in the frequency of miscarriages, sterility, low birth weight, stillbirths, and again, sex ratio at birth, also called sex odds or male to female. The last three traits are very interesting as they can be assessed by exhausting demographic population-based official routine statistics. For those of you who are interested in more details about radiation-induced genetic effects, I recommend reading, for example, an article by Schmitz Feuerhage, Chris Busby, and Sebastian Flugbeil, Genetic Radiation Risks, a Neglected Topic in the Low Dose Debate. These authors conclude that the current risk model for heritable effects of radiation is unsafe. Another interesting paper is by Preston et al. Title is Uncertainties in Estimating Health Risks Associated with Exposure to Ionizing Radiation. They say there remain significant uncertainties related to dose assessment, low dose and low dose rate extrapolation. And finally, I and Christina Vogt published in 2011 the human sex odds at birth after the atmospheric bomb tests after Chernobyl and in the vicinity of nuclear facilities. We estimated the persistently disturbed human sex odds after the Chernobyl accident allow the estimation of the global deficit of birth in the range of several millions. An interesting question is, which is the official genetic risk perception, for example, by the International Commission on Radiological Protection, ICRP? And how does this perception relate to our findings? This can be demonstrated considering the radiation risk of congenital abnormalities. ICRP assumes, based on animal data, 2,000 excess congenital abnormalities per 1 million births exposed to one gray over a generation. If we take perinatal mortality as a provisional surrogate for severe birth defects and apply our most recent risk estimate based on comprehensive Fukushima data of 1.34 per microsievert per hour to the baseline level by ICRP of 6% malformations, we obtain nearly 90,000 excess malformations instead of 2,000 excess malformations in the scenario of one gray per generation. This lets us conjecture that the ICRP risk for birth defects is in error by a factor in the order of 50. Now let us have a short look at low dose. What is a low dose? A low dose or low dose rate is clearly the everyday dose we experience by the natural background radiation, say 0.1 microsievert per hour or 1 millisievert per year, respectively. Any additional artificial radiation is on top of the natural background. Even an up to 100-fold excess dose and an up to 60,000-fold dose rate is declared low by the radiation circles. In contrast, for example, Matthews et al. Provided direct evidence of increased cancer risk in children in the one-digit millisievert range. Consequently, Palmans et al. Consider the concept energy per mass irrelevant. They question the validity of the concept sievert based on energy per mass joule per kilogram for the assessment of biological radiation effects at the cellular molecular level. Energy per mass cannot adequately describe and quantify radiation damage at the cellular and molecular level simply because it cannot be measured at that level. Our studies on genetic effects after Chernobyl and Fukushima corroborate these findings and assessments. On this slide, I listed relatively early pertinent Chernobyl-related reproductive health outcome studies during the 1990s. These investigations addressed and compared before and after Chernobyl, Down syndrome, impaired female reproduction function, perinatal mortality in Germany, and cleft lip and palate in the former GDR. All these studies found significant detrimental reproductive effects ignored or downplayed by the established radiation sciences and by international and national radiological protection entities. Koeplein and Küchenhoff's investigation, published in 1997, is particularly interesting. What did they look at and what did they see? They considered the annual perinatal mortality rate in Germany from 1980 to 1993. Perinatal mortality was then defined as stillbirth or death of the newborn within 7 days of birth and a weight limit of 1 kilogram. This corresponds approximately to a pregnancy length of 28 weeks. Koeplein and Kuzhinov essentially tested whether the perinatal mortality was increased in 1987 as a possible consequence of Chernobyl. And indeed, the visible slight uptick of the mortality proportion in this figure is significant because of the following outcome. A one-sided test shows a p-value below 1%, and the excess perinatal death is 4.8%, which is equivalent to over 300 excess cases in 1987. After Koeplein and Kuzhinov's initiating work, we formed a small group at the Helmholtz Center Munich, and we studied stillbirth, perinatal mortality, and congenital malformation in Germany and Europe in more detail. We looked at stillbirth in Europe at the country level and in Bavaria at the district level. We reanalyzed perinatal deaths in Germany, stratifying Germany by differently contaminated parts. Moreover, we also looked quite carefully at congenital malformations in Bavaria and in the former GDR at the district level. We also studied Down syndrome in Europe in cooperation with Karl Sperling and Heidemarie Neitzel from the Charité in Berlin. We found many positive radiation-induced genetic effects, which is documented in these five papers. This is the main result of our European stillbirth study as of 1999. In the four Eastern countries, Sweden, Poland, Hungary, and Greece, stillbirth increased in the long run by nearly 10%. Such an effect was absent in the Western and Central parts of Europe. Note today in Japan about 80% of perinatal mortality is stillbirth. Hence, if stillbirth is affected by radiation, so is perinatal mortality. The yellow area in the figure accounts for 1,600 excess stillbirth cases in those four Eastern countries considered. Extrapolating this to all of Europe and especially to longer time periods may mean more than 100,000 additional stillbirths after Chernobyl in Europe in the long run. Given our experiences with Chernobyl-related reproductive health effects, it was no major surprise that we were approached someday by Japanese doctors to also study perinatal morbidity and mortality in Japan before and after Fukushima. The simple question, is perinatal mortality in Japan impacted after Fukushima, had a simple answer, yes. Our initiation study, a replication and extension by Koeplein and Kuzhinov, and a further update study by me and the Japanese physicians are documented in these three publications. This slide summarizes the essentials of a further extension of our Japanese perinatal study. We can now cover 1995 to 2019 with more than 27 million live births and over 130,000 perinatal deaths. Cesium contamination levels for all 47 prefectures is provided by the Yasunari et al. Paper, and our paper from summer 2020 about low birth weight contains as a byproduct detailed reanalysis of the Yasunari paper to make their data fit our purposes. This list compiles the original Yasunari cesium deposition data, our corresponding rescaled levels, and our translation of deposition to dose rate for all 47 individual prefectures. The list shows that the dose rate ranges from nearly 1 microsievert per hour in Fukushima to a negligible level above the background of 0.05 microsievert per hour in Okinawa. The simple plan we have in mind should be obvious. The plan is to correlate prefecture-specific level shifts in perinatal mortality with the prefecture-specific dose rate after Fukushima. This is a geographic region value plot of the Descartic logarithm for the rescaled cesium-137 deposition in the 47 Japanese prefectures after Fukushima. It is a graphical representation of the list on the previous slide. The positions of the earthquake epicenter, the nuclear power plant, and the 300-kilometer geocircle around the power plant are indicated additionally. In the first step, we may look, for example, at the perinatal mortality trend in the combined five most contaminated prefectures, Fukushima, Miyagi, Ibaraki, Tochigi, and Iwate. We see a significant jump in the perinatal mortality of nearly 16% with a p-value of 3 in 10,000. In analogy, in a second step, we find a smaller shift of 6.2% with a p-value 0.0041 in the five moderately contaminated prefectures Yamagata, Saitama, Tokyo, Kanagawa, and Chiba. Finally, in the third step, we analyze the perinatal mortality trend in the 37 less contaminated prefectures. It shows that the level shift is further slightly decreasing to 4.5%, but it remains still significant with p-value 0.0042. As I announced before, we can generalize these analyses from only three groups of prefectures to all 47 prefectures. This enables us to plot the level shift in each prefecture against the individual prefecture's contamination levels or dose rates, no matter, of course, whether the level shifts are up or down. The objective of this approach is to estimate an ecological dose response association. The figure on this slide reflects the main result of our plan. We can see, indeed, a highly significant association between the dose rate and the level shifts from 2012 across the 47 prefectures of Japan. The jump odds ratio, which describes the amount of level shift, turns out to be over 30% per microsievert per hour. While the approach on this slide is well suited for illustration purposes, it is rather indirect and not optimum. An alternative, optimum, direct, and rather elegant method is to regress the level shifts directly on the dose rate in only one step in one logistic regression equation, and not to determine the individual jump heights separately as on the slide before. This highly efficient method is outlined on this slide. The logistic regression of the perinatal mortality proportion and dose rate is adjusted for prefecture-specific baseline trends and for the tsunami and for all second-order interactions. This yields a rather precise estimate of the mortality risk of 1.34 per microsievert per hour. Now, I will treat the low birth weight issue. As mentioned before, low birth weight may well serve as a sentinel indicator for unhealthy environmental conditions. Low birth weight is defined as a weight at birth of below 2,500 grams. Japan is among the five countries worldwide with the highest low birth weight proportions in the range of 9 to 10%. Limited evidence of radiation impact on low birth weight was provided by a study among the atomic bomb survivors. Obviously, low birth weight prevalence may be correlated with cesium deposition or dose rate in much the same way as it was in our perinatal study. While the update of our perinatal studies I presented until here has not yet been published, the rest of my presentation concerns our low birth weight study published last year summer in the journal Environmental Health. This is a concise profile of this study. The period covered is 1995 to 2018 with annual and not monthly data as in our perinatal study. Based on 1,128 prefectures years, This study accounts for over 26 million live births, including overall 9% low birth weight cases. The authors of this study are Kei Hayashi from Osaka and me. The methodological framework of our low birth weight study is identical to that of our perinatal study outlined before. However, the trend models are a bit more complicated. Whereas we could use simple first-order linear logistic trend models, we needed fourth-order logistic polynomials for our low birth weight study. The figure on this slide depicts the low birth weight proportion time trend in the five most contaminated prefectures, Fukushima, Miyagi, Ibaraki, Tochigi, and Iwate. We can see a rather curved trend and a distinct significant jump after Fukushima from 2012 onward. The jump measures 5.5% with p-value 1%. In the five moderately contaminated prefectures, Yamagata, Saitama, Tokyo, Kanagawa, and Chiba, the low birth weight proportion reveals again a significant jump of 2.1% after Fukushima. In the 37 less contaminated prefectures, the jump is further reduced to 1.5% and no longer significant at the 5% error level. The p-value is 0.1045. This figure visualizes the positive and significant association between the dose rate and the level shifts in the low birth weight trends of the 47 prefectures. In this analysis and results presentation, the low birth weight proportion increases by 11% per 1 microsievert per hour increase in the dose rate. Again, the most efficient and elegant method is direct linear logistic regression of the low birth weight proportion on the dose rate adjusted for aquatic baseline trends, specific for each prefecture. The result is a highly significant, nearly 10% increase of the low birth weight proportion per 1 microsievert per hour. More recent supporting evidence has provided in the meantime. Murase et al. Studied nationwide increase in cryptogorgidism. This is a malformation of boys after the Fukushima nuclear accident. Murase et al. Nationwide increase in complex congenital heart diseases after the Fukushima nuclear accident. And Korsakov et al., a most recent publication from last year, de novo congenital malformation frequencies in children from Bryansk region following the Chernobyl disaster. Now with my conclusions, the end of this presentation is near. Radiation-induced genetic effects increased after Fukushima, like after Chernobyl. Perinatal death odds increases per microsievert per hour by 34%. Low birth weight odds increases per microsievert per hour by 10%. Intensifying research in radiation-induced genetic effects and exposure pathways is urgently needed. For the protection of the natural gene pool of animate beings, immediate action is required, especially in view of the large amounts of low to highly active wastes, for which no safe solutions exist, and which constantly enter the biosphere due to insufficient awareness and regulation. Regrettably, we face intractable dogmas. Radiation safety institutions around the globe do not seriously and systematically consider radiation-induced genetic effects. For example, Joachim Breckow, former head of the German Strahlenschutz Commission, claimed stillbirths or miscarriages are not assigned to stochastic radiation effects. This is sustainable violation of common sense and ignorant of scientific evidence. I will close with a rather pessimistic outlook, citing a famous scientist. He concludes, Ioannidis concludes, any deviation from the principle that seeking the truth has priority over any other goals may be seriously damaging the self-correcting functions of science. Or even more radically and pessimistically by George Orwell, and if all others accepted the lie which the party imposed, if all records told the same tale, then the lie passed into history and became truth. Thank you for your interest and attention.